And according to Jessica Gore Nemhart, there were several hundred economically independent black commons. Garvey's UNIA was the physical manifestation of his belief in doing for self. Through support of the people, they financed a fleet of ships called the Black Star Line, estimated to be worth at least $500,000. Additionally, they maintained grocery stores, a restaurant, a laundromat, tailor, a millinery and dressmaking shop, and a publishing house. We haven't seen the likes of these efforts since we traded self-reliance for politics, of which have effectively done the job of erasing independence, exchanging it for dependence. In Brooklyn, Paragon went on to create the first black credit union. We find every member of Paragon was also a member of the local UNIA. These ancestors were keeping the idea of Garvey's cooperative economics alive merely under another name. But as the UNIA faced attacks from both white and black Americans for solely attempting to lift POADUS from our lowly state, which was not coincidentally the same time we refused grant relief, it was instinctively natural for these Garveyites to take the task and show and prove a tangible working mode of self-reliance. In many cases, since local banks found us a risk to grant loans for college tuition, mortgages, or unexpected expenses, received support from Paragon. From 1940s through the 50s, Paragon provided financial backing for POADUS to open candy stores, laundromats, restaurants, and printing shops. From this model, we see it was through cooperatives we're able to not only create and support our own economic and business ventures, it also can galvanize leverage for things we all need, like group life and death insurance, as well as other health benefits. The plus is knowing this model works. Paragon grew from $5,000 to $6 million in assets, becoming the example, vanguard, and then facing expulsion from our community as white financial institutions witnessed the true essence of self-reliance and creativity despite facing segregation. What we see and have now are the results of them eliminating our plans of self-determination through politics, which led to gentrification, which next resulted in alternative white businesses that still exist in our communities today. Since Paragon and the height of the UNIA, there hasn't been an effective organization like this in sight. And this wasn't even 100 years ago. See, white folks who give the impression we are worthless and they'd rather do without are in fact doing the opposite. The black gold we were once referred to as kidnapped vassals or thralls, a more appropriate word for slave, they found to be more valuable as consumers. They're effectively able to do this still through our absence of knowing history, erasing it from our history books, while at the same time swarming in our communities in numbers as if the UNIA or Paragon ever existed. The metaphorical Achilles of our movement is not money, and it's not history. It's actually something more taxing. In fact, it's antithetical to our claim of love for black people and culture. What could such a thing be, you might ask? It's psychological, and the ailment is simple. It's our lack of trust in each other.
Listen. Yes, us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must trust us, discuss trusting us. Us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must trust us, discuss us, trusting us. Trusting us, us must trust, discuss. Discuss not trusting us, must not fuss. Us with us means us discussing, trusting us. Us must trust us. Who? Us must trust, not fuss with us. Us must discuss trusting us. But am I over your head? Yo, am I over your head?
Collectively, we're the most disunited ethnic demographic on the chart. And while most of our dysfunction can be attributed to global racism, much of it today is on autopilot. Meaning, through our collective ignorance of what you've heard thus far is driven by our reluctance to see it as such. A dysfunction that is curable. We've been lulled to sleep into believing democracy serves the people, when we've clearly been the last in line. All of our social, economic, and health ills have yet to be addressed, and it's about time we realize they may never, unless we attend to these issues ourselves. The Depression of the 1930s should serve as an era of study. From hard times emerged the need to establish a sense of community, helping each other and sharing. It's 80 years plus later. Are we not yet again in the same boat? There is no need to reinvent the wheel to save ourselves. The base of our Black sustainable survival lie in the work of our ancestors. We merely need to duplicate their successes and learn from their mistakes. I find this will only be accomplished through cooperatives, coupled with trust. Looking for a solution? I'd like to share one with you. I represent a fourth of the founding members from Brooklyn, New York, with strong Caribbean roots and a passion for nature and the environment, who decided in 2012 to create Duende Natural. Our aim is to create an ecological, sustainable future for ourselves, our children, and our communities. We go by the virtues of living in nature, for nature lives within us, and natural, organic, and earth-friendly practices is an everyday practice and lifestyle. We use earth-based living skills, nature awareness, and indigenous practices to create a partnership within our members, visitors, students, and the environment, using the tenets of permaculture, of which there are three ethics: care for the earth, care for people, and fair trade. In 2013, we bought 10 acres of pristine raw jungle on the Caribbean coast of Costa Rica. Part of it will be an eco lodge and the rest an intentional community. As beautiful and peaceful as Costa Rica is, after the noticeable increase of social response, namely by the Black Lives Matter movement, we realized the need to address our collective domestic hardships was in need of immediate attention. At the core of POADUS problems is the increased loss of land ownership. Black Land Matters was born. Most of the time, investment in real estate and concern for local community are seen as oxymoronic. For example, Brooklyn, New York is now the most expensive real estate market in the United States. If you hear this and you own real estate in Brooklyn, or your pension is invested in urban real estate, you smile as if you made a wise investment. But if you rent in Brooklyn, you see displacement and loss of community in your future. This is happening in urban cities all around the country. But what if investment in real estate and concern for local community went together? With the Real Estate Investment Cooperative for Permanently Affordable Space, we are doing just this, by combining people power with money power. As a member of Black Land Matters Real Estate Investment Cooperative, BLM REIC for short, you will receive details of domestic and international projects and listings. Wherever Black folk are, Black land matters. Our purpose is to pool our money to create a fund that we manage together. If 1,000 people give $100 to the fund, we have $100,000 to work with. But if 10,000 give $100 to the fund, that's $1 million. We are using the power of social media networking to bring economic possibilities to our people. We can decide to inject capital into projects that, one, buy land property from private owners to stabilize existing businesses and community spaces, and two, turn vacant properties into sustainable community resources. Members join BLM REIC for a $50 annual investment for a voting share. We decide together as a cooperative how to spend the money we pool. Each project we invest in will have both social value and be financially feasible. Because winning as an individual is quite difficult, everyone seems to be trying to solve this problem of affordability on an individual level. I've shown you historically, we've learned that past successes relied on people working together, on aggregation and scale, and not on the individual. Building a co-op pool of resources enable group improvement and sustainability instead of doing it on your own. through BLM's parent company, Duende Natural. We have a model intended to create intentional communities of like-minded folks focused on land as well as food sovereignty via the use of the same practices of our ancestors, cooperatives. Our reasons for creating BLM REIC are the following. We believe African diasporic heritage-based communities must come together to pool resources and share our experiences as we reclaim our sacred connection with the earth. We want returns on our investments to be made locally. We want to shape our communities together. We want to see development without displacement. We want to support space for art and culture. And we want to preserve a business or community space in our own neighborhoods. Black Land Matters serves as a space to learn, think deeply, radically, and personally about the best ways to keep our communities on the land and keep it alive and green for ensuing generations. We're working together to secure cooperatively purchased and permanently owned black land. In this time of climate change and dwindling natural resources, it's imperative that we implement these practices which will support community and earth sustainability. The properties we currently seek are to be acquired in New York City, Philadelphia, the Baltimore, D.C. region, Atlanta, and California, with other areas to follow based on demand, resources, and the ability to organize divisions that include international sites. If any of this speaks to you, consider joining us at our virtual and in-person soirees to learn more at this link. And if you haven't already, join the BLM REIC membership today at this link. And lastly, consider coming with us on one of our domestic and international tours to Costa Rica and see for yourself. Go to our site for details of this year's tours. Asante Sana, Ubuntu,
Abibi Fahodie.
Children of nature. Still holding on, had to survive.